All right, welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat.
503.
Man, how did that one taste? Number one in the country in the AP poll. I don't even know if we're ever going to be number one in BCS.
Yeah, it's difficult, man. I don't know.
Man, that felt good. What do you think about that UCLA game?
Yeah, that was sweet, man. Like, I thought they were going to, not to sound like a jackass, but I thought they would have had a little bit tougher time. And I'm surprised that the UCLA running game, which actually was... It was a little bit effective in the first half to the tune of a whopping six points. But
Field goals are not going to work against the Ducks.
Right, yeah. But, man, I was really impressed. And the numbers they put up, the Ducks, and then the Ducks' defense, like I was telling you before, that's the thing that I've always been admiring, is that it's great to put up 60, but the other team is, you know, scoring in the high 40s. It's a little closer than you like. So the fact that they kept them to 13,
yeah,
and with that last fourth quarter score, which was the only score Oregon's given up all year in the fourth quarter. So that's what I like to see. What about you, man?
Man, I was just impressed. I go to the games with my family, and sixth row, sit right behind the bench of the UCLA side. And so you get to see these guys just hang.
Yeah.
They come to the sideline, and they're just dragging.
Yeah.
First, second possession, whatever. they came in and they were pretty fired up. And boy, they just took the air out of the sails real quick. First score was huge for the Ducks. And again, it's about Thomas being able to pass the ball efficiently or run the ball efficiently early in the game.
Yeah.
If Thomas makes them freeze, it's LaMichael all day, every day. Yeah. Or whoever. Remine had a great day.
Yeah, Remine did.
But, man, Thomas came up, hit Paulson across the middle, hit Mayo on the side, just came down, hit a couple key receivers, just got the ball moving.
Yeah, they started out with passing plays to start the game with.
And then that freezes that DN, and then as soon as those DNs start to crash to try to break down the pass, Thomas runs on the outside, gets the first down, and then they're just stuck, and they're just stuck. So I was really impressed with that. What did you think about, how did it look on TV from your perspective with the yellow and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, it looked...
ESPN's on the jock now. ESPN's really...
Yeah, they like it. Yeah, I thought it looked pretty sweet. The Ducks came out with the yellow unis, and they were, they were working it. You could tell that just by looking at them that they're one of the top programs now, the way they present themselves. And
the presentation
the swagger. Great.
Presentation's great, man, and just the color scheme. I mean, in Autzen, it was really pretty amazing. I didn't think it was going to be as yellow as it was, but it turned out to be.
Yeah, it was
right
awesome,
there.
Man. Yeah, I really dug it.
Yeah, I remember back in the old days of Autzen where they used to lay out the little pom poms on your seat. You know, you get to the seat and you have the pom poms, so everybody's shaking the pom pom, and it would be pretty yellow doing that. That's kind of what I was thinking this week going into it.
Yeah, because they had the like the yellow out or whatever at the game. Yeah, it was cool, man. I like that.
So I'm absolutely addicted. I'm just a junkie. I woke up Friday thinking about it. I got home super late, but then had you know, just the ideology of needing more. I don't know why, but you beat the living hell out of a team, and I couldn't help, but I've already watched the replay like twice.
Have you? Yeah.
I've gone on the ESPN 3, watched that again, and watched it again on the Go Ducks site. I mean, it's just, and I love seeing how well Autzen plays out. I mean, I got this picture right here that I keep looking at, and that's last year's Autzen for the Purdue game, and it's a completely different field this year. It's a completely different wrap around the stadium, and the production value, when you see it on camera, it is beautiful. Yeah. It is a beautiful presentation.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about SC. You worried about SC?
No, not really. I don't want to overlook them, obviously, because, you know, they can have a good day, I guess. But I don't think that SC, I don't think their defense is good enough to hang with Oregon, considering that I think, was it the Bruins that had a better ranked defense than the Trojans?
I think going into it, they did. But I think that Oregon kind of hurt
the record. But
putting 60 on them.
Yeah, because I think... USC might be able to score a few times. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if they got a couple touchdowns.
I wouldn't be surprised if it looked kind of like Stanford.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. But, but you know, with some of the a little bit better teams, and plus, you know, they'll know each other from playing each other in years past a little bit, even though the USC has a new coaching staff there. But
You think that'll make a difference, Kiffin?
I think it'll be a detraction. I don't think they'll be as... Like, if Carroll was there, because I know Carroll lost a few games his final year, and the team was kind of looking like they were on a downswing, but I would be more afraid if Carroll was still there than I am with Kiffin there now.
Yeah, I don't think Kiffin's that good of a coach. I mean, I really don't. I think that he's had the name from his dad. He has the name. He's gone around. I don't think he did that good of a job in the pros, and then he went down to the college ranks, and then I don't think he did that good of a job at Tennessee. He left there for SC. Yeah. We'll see about SC, but he has sanctions. He has kind of an excuse built in there.
Yeah.
Here's my thoughts. I personally, I think that Oregon is the most fit team in college football. Their offensive and defensive linemen are absolutely cut. They're trim. They don't have guts hanging off.
Yeah.
They aren't big, roly-poly
dudes. Yeah, they were saying UCLA's line averaged 317.
Dude, they were so fat. It wasn't like they were big. They were fat. You could see them roll it. And I think SC is very similar. SC has great athletes. But I think that the defensive line is a same kind of mentality of the NFL. Like, the NFL defensive line, you should be just gigantic. Albert Hainsworth.
Yeah, just lay on the guy in front of you and clog up the front.
Yeah, but the guy who was the leader in the sacks for Oregon a couple years ago, Nick Reed, went to the, and he's not fat.
Yeah.
The guy who now is leader in sacks is Kenny Rowe, and he's not.
Yeah.
And he's got these speed rush guys off the edge, and I think that these guys in the middle are just big, and they just can't hang. And I think that they're slow. They're just slow.
Yeah.
They're slow to react to the ball. They're slow to get through the hole. They're slow to catch their breath to get back up to the line. I think all those things Oregon will exploit. And after three or four quarters, they're going to be dragging.
Yeah.
I heard on an interview with LaMichael last week, you can't train for Oregon in 1 week.
Yeah,
you got to start training last year.
Yeah,
you got to do it in the offseason. You can't come in 1 week and expect to be able to hang with a team that's been doing this kind of strength and conditioning.
Yeah, I know. I heard that.
And that's the difference. I think that the football is actually, I think that Oregon has good, great athletes and a good scheme. They're running just straight up old school football, read, option, football. But I think that their conditioning is what's better than anybody else.
Yeah, I agree with you on that, definitely. And because you can't just take the thing that I don't think Oregon gets much credit for is you can't just take a team and all of a sudden say, okay, let's run the no huddle for the entire game, basically.
Yeah, and not make a mistake.
Yeah, exactly. Regardless of who it is, it seems like if you try to run that kind of offense, you're getting mental errors.
Yes.
Because you're all go, go, go. Let's get to the line, snap it. Whoop, illegal formation. You know, that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
And the Ducks, they're disciplined, man. They have it down. So, and I think, it goes to Chip Kelly, too. I mean, it's tempo, tempo, tempo.
Yeah.
Get to the ball, get the call, get the snap, and go. You know,
I think to that same point, I think when the offense tries to then run a 2-minute drill, the defense for Oregon knows what they're looking at.
They
look at it all the time.
Every week,
so why is that even a problem?
I
think SC is a great team. They have the tradition, they have the history, blah 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 blah. But this is 2010.
Yeah.
And in 2009 they got B2. So this is not 2005. It's not Marcus Allen. It's not O.J. Simpson.
Yeah.
It's none of that.
Yeah.
It's about right now. And right now, Oregon has better players than SC.
Yeah.
They have better players because they do better things with them.
Mm-hmm.
SC comes has a 5-star recruit. Oregon has a 4-star recruit. At the end of the game, at the end of their career, whatever you want to call it, college career, that 5-star recruit is going to go to the NFL. He's going to be trained. He's going to go. He's going to go through the NFL.
Yeah.
But the 4-star recruit at Oregon goes up a notch and also goes in at the NFL level.
Yeah.
Now, that's, I think, the difference in college is that growth shows explosiveness on the field.
Mm-hmm.
You take these guys who are the best of the best coming in as freshmen, and they play and they play and they play, and then they're done. You get these guys for Oregon, and they start to move up the ladder a little bit.
Yeah.
Man, I'm telling you, Oregon right now looks like SC did a couple, 3 years ago when they just have a stockpile of running backs.
Yeah.
They have a stockpile of linebackers.
Yep.
You bring a guy out, a guy gets hurt. You know, Kenyon Barner, quite possibly, is one of the best running backs in the country, and he's not starting.
Yeah.
He doesn't play, and he hasn't played since he got hurt, and there's no problem. He could not play the rest of the year, and there'd still be no problem.
Yeah, because they got it.
And not only that, but you also talk about on the defensive side, the strength and conditioning for Oregon's defense. They rotate these guys in. They have new linebackers. They play more downs than anybody, but they also play more people than anybody. Yeah. They've got guys coming in on the corners. Guys coming in. I saw a great play where Cliff Harris, who is just starting, who ESPN is loving right now, he goes to the edge, gets hit, gets the wind knocked out of him, goes back to the sideline. They shift over Talmadge Jackson III to where Cliff Harris was, and they put Javis Lewis on the other guy. And right there, boom, the play comes over. They tackle the guy. In comes Cliff Harris again. There was nothing.
Yeah, no drop off.
There's no drop off. Yeah. And I think that if you start looking at teams, that's the difference between good and great.
Yeah.
When you can have a whole crew of players play the same way.
Yeah.
When you lose the number one guy on the defensive side of the football and you bring in the number two, there's not that big of a drop off. It's a team oriented thing, and I think that's the secret of Oregon's success.
I agree. Yeah, it's not like we're putting all of our eggs in the basket of one stud on offense or defense.
And it's strength and conditioning, and it's depth.
Yeah.
And then you have a pretty good system that's pretty much, you can't stop that system.
Yeah.
Because there's always going to be an option. Like I'm saying earlier, Darren Thomas starts throwing the ball, so then you start rushing him, and then he runs past you because you start rushing him.
Mm-hmm.
Once you stay the course and try to stay contained, bring LaMichael up the middle.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, and
what are you going to do?
Yeah, LaMichael looked good against UCLA. He got the wind knocked out of him, I guess he did.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't sure what was wrong with him at first. I was
He went down,
worried.
Didn't get up.
Yeah, he was down by the goal line there.
That was on the very far side of the field from where we sit.
Was it? Yeah, but, you know, he turned out to be okay. I think one thing the Ducks don't get a lot of credit for is the speed that they have, because they have good speed on offense. They have good speed on the defense, too.
Oh, incredible speed
on
defense.
So you bring these teams in that may have given them a problem in the past just because they have burners on the outside or something. But, the Ducks have great defensive speed, too.
And I think that's, again, when you go back to SC, I'm not trying to say Oregon is as good as SC was when SC was the number one team in the country. But Oregon's the number one or number two team in the country right now. So why can't we start saying that they're really close?
Yeah.
And the reason why they're close is because of conditioning and depth. And I think they have better conditioning than SC had. But the point that I'm trying to make is if you're fast and if you can spread the field out, when SC was dominant, it wasn't that they were stopping every play at the line of scrimmage. Sometimes they would go 20, 30 yards deep into the coverage, and SC would fly to the football and stop the ball.
Yeah.
They would fly to the football and dislodge the ball from the receiver.
Yeah.
There wouldn't be really a play to be made, and then all of a sudden, here comes this or this or this or any of those guys in the past.
Yeah.
And those guys are so fast that they're able to put out the fire really quickly and not let an offensive play go overboard.
Yeah, no big plays.
Yeah, and that's Oregon. Don't break.
Yeah.
So you can let them go 20 yards down the field.
Yeah.
That's fine. It's not going to do anything.
Yeah.
You're going to catch up. And every time if you watch the Ducks, there's always two or three or four or five or eight different helmets on the ball. They fly to the ball. And that's that old school gangrene idea when they first went to the Rose Bowl when we were in high school, is put helmets on the ball. You don't need to have one guy be, whoever, you know,
you don't need to be a Ray Lewis.
You don't need to be an Urlacher. You don't need to be an LT. You know, you need to have a group of guys flying after the ball.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good team that they have.
Exactly. Okay, let's get some predictions, bud. What do you think? SC, bud?
I think they'll be an SC by, I think it'll be like, I'm going to call it like 50 to 21.
Yeah, see, I look at it a lot like last year. Last year, I think they were 20 to 21 going into halftime or something like that. They were like tied at half, maybe.
Yeah.
I look at it like that. I mean, I think they ended the game 40 point blowout. Or a 20 point blowout. I think it was like 41 to 20 or something like that.
Yeah.
And I could see it being like Stanford. I could see SC maybe even being ahead in the first half.
And then the second half is when the
way I look at it is it's like golf to me. When you start off, you start with the same score.
Yeah.
It's going to take a couple holes to start building the separation between the players.
Right. Yeah.
Football, the first couple quarters, you're even.
Yeah.
So it takes to the third and fourth quarter. That's when you actually separate. That's when you can tell the teams that are different.
Yeah, and that's also where conditioning comes in.
Booyah.
Yep.
Okay, guys. Welcome, everybody who has not seen our clips before. Anybody who has seen our videos before, thanks again for watching. We love you guys. Addicted to Quack. All the Oregon Live, wherever else it's going all over the place on the internet. But mainly YouTube. Thanks a lot for letting us be part of this.